whole idea here is to get people to know what's going on. I think it's more important to know and then make responsible, intelligent decisions off of that. So today, we're going to start with a keynote by Ms. Kristen Harris, an immigration attorney, who has a real profound background in immigration. She started, obviously, at Yale and Michigan, but then she made her way working for a nonprofit in Chicago. She was the advocacy chair on the IMG task force. She also was involved with the Immigration Affinity Group. She's actually the top 40 under 40 in a major law publication, and now she's involved with her own immigration firm.
Thank you. Thanks very much, and thank you so much for the opportunity to speak about immigration and U.S. healthcare. Never has it been more important than now to be both apprised of very, very recent developments that have already occurred and are probably likely to continue to occur. I also want to explain that part of the reason that I do what I do is because of a recognition that indeed, we do have an ongoing chronic shortage of physicians. And you know, that is something, seems like we're losing our feet once in a while. That's something that continues to be a problem. And foreign national, international medical graduates and international medical graduates have been a big part of the solution, as well as US medical graduates. So I wanted to kind of have a couple of different goals for us today, and there will also, of course, be Q&A at the conclusion. One thing is to have a basic understanding of the common immigration status for graduate medical education. I'll keep saying that again and again, GME, graduate medical education. That way I'm talking about both, you know, residencies and fellowships, GME. Also talking about the most recent presidential executive orders on immigration that most affect academic medicine. I mean, there have been many, many executive orders that relate to immigration, but I'm going to be focusing on those that do impact, unfortunately, every foreign national, international medical graduate, not just foreign nationals from the six. And then I want us to also talk about where you can look to and be ready and prepared in awareness of possible future developments. So first and foremost, just to give you a real brief primer, I think to understand both how the executive orders work and also how business as usual works, for those who are coming into graduate medical education or GME and looking at these different state actors, these different agencies. So first of all, you have the State Department, or DOS, it's sometimes called. The State Department is, you know, headquartered here in the United States, but obviously has consulates and embassies all throughout the world. Those U.S., so the headquarters is will send out memos and consular cables and all of that kind of thing to the U.S. consular posts. And the U.S. consular posts are then having to interpret, you know, how do we carry out this cable that tells us how to adjudicate this executive order? And that's going to be very key, as I'll talk about next. There's a National Visa Center here in the United States that doesn't affect most, you know, foreign national IMGs. There's also the Department of Homeland Security, which is a massive, massive, massive agency, but then it has these other important sub-agencies. It has Customs and Border Protection. Customs, I'm seeing some nods in the audience. These are the people at the airport when you present your passport that look at your passport, screen it through, et cetera. That's CBP. And they were always important, but now their role is all the more important, as we all saw in that first week, especially after the first travel ban. Customs and Border Protection, it's up to them to try to interpret all of these and who they're letting in and how much screening goes on. Already once you're on the flight, already when you get off that airplane. So that's CBP. There's also USCIS. We're going to talk about them a little bit more as well. So I oftentimes call them the warm, fuzzy benefit part of immigration, to the extent that immigration can never be warm and fuzzy. And basically, USCIS is in charge of adjudicating petitions, for the most part, for people who are already here in the United States. So for example, if you're here in the United States on a B1 or on an F1 and you've matched and you're trying to change your status to either J1 or H1 to start your GME by around July 1, USCIS will be a big role in that. State Department could be, depending on how much time you have, and we'll talk about the details on that. Then there's also ICE, Immigration and Customs Enforcement, and ICE is, you know, the part of DHS that is kind of the scariest. These are the people that carry out the enforcement raids. These are the people, to pick up people on detainer for deportation removal, et cetera. So thankfully, I can say for most of academic medicine, you really don't need to worry about ICE, but this is just so you know all of the state players that get involved with immigration. I'm not going to talk about the January executive order because that was already rescinded and revised with the reissued March 6th executive order. So first of all, the March 6th executive order is already went into effect, but immediately upon it going into effect, there were temporary restraining orders by courts that said, wait, no, we need to be thoughtful about this. We're not going to let you carry out all of the executive order. Now, some of the executive order is still in place and does impact this whole GME process, but there was, so I'm gonna talk about, and the other thing is that there was these orders that are freezing certain parts of the executive order. They're temporary, they're TROs, they're temporary restraining orders. There's no final decision from any court yet that says these executive orders are completely without effect, okay? So we only have a very, so that's why we're gonna talk a little bit about the nitty gritty of the overall executive order. It did roll back from the first order the nations of concern. So now we're looking at Iran, Libya, Somalia, Sudan, Syria, and Yemen, not Iraq. They also, in the new executive order, they rolled back, or they would say clarified, limitations so that it's not everyone from these now six countries. So for example, for those who are green card holders, I know there was a question that came in already about somebody who has the green card through the diversity lottery. Green card holders who are from these nations, even if you hold citizenship or nationality from those six, you are not within the scope of the order. You should be able to come and go and have your visa, you know, adjudicated, everything just like anybody else. The same thing with those who have dual citizenship. So long as you enter the United States on the passport of the nationality that is not one of these six countries, you will be admitted in just like everyone else. Similarly, another rollback in the first order, it was anyone who had traveled to any one of the six plus Iraq countries. Since a certain date forward was also banned, that's no longer there. So it does, so the scope of the executive order and even the 90-day travel suspension automatic has been you know, brought in quite a bit. The other thing to note before I leave this slide, and I'm looking out and I'm seeing many people who are probably here physically in the United States, either on January 27th, the first date of the first order, or who are here on the first date of the executive order. Amazingly enough, all those populations also excluded from the 90-day travel ban. Now, I think generally speaking, there is so much uncertainty and concern that people are not saying, oh, well, I happen to have been here on one of those dates, so I can travel in and out, I'm not worried. You know, but on the other hand, if you look at just even the letter of the executive order as written, you would not be within the scope. Okay, and then there also are waivers, and there are waivers from this travel ban suspension for those who are maybe listening in who are right now outside the United States, maybe one of those six, six countries. One other bit of scope that's interesting, if an individual was not here physically in the United States, but even had a current valid visa, a current valid U.S. visa stamp in their passport, as of the date of the first executive order, January 27th, or as of the date of the first effective date of the second executive order, those individuals are also not within the scope of this travel ban, in the newly released travel ban. I think this was probably in response to arguments that had been made by the plaintiffs in the lawsuit for the first order, but whatever, we're just happy that it got rolled back a bit. Okay. So in terms of Section 3 executive order waivers, so if after going through all of those exceptions, you're still within the scope of the order, you can still ask for a waiver of the ban of your ability to reenter the U.S. As long as you can show three elements. First, you would face undue hardship. Second, you're not a security risk. Third, your coming in would be in the national interest, that's U.S. national interest. So those are the three must-have. In addition, there are subsection waivers, and in effect, there are different subsection waivers that could work very nicely for those who are already in graduate medical education and coming back to resume it. There's even a couple of subsections that could work insofar as if you have matched and you've already done your visa interviews and perhaps you've taken USMLE preparation at Kaplan or something like that, that may be deemed to have had a significant enough contact with the United States and you're coming in now to carry out your professional commitment, which would be, right, the match, if you match and you say, yes, if I match, I promise I'll come in. So those could be, you know, that would not qualify as the foundation. You still need the foundation, but there are some subsection waivers that could help so that those who are outside the U.S. who've matched could actually come in, could still apply for a visa even during the 90-day suspension, even if the temporary restraining orders are no longer in effect and get overruled. Okay, there's also something that's very important to every single foreign national, regardless of your nationality. So even if you're not one of those six countries, there's a Section 5 in the first order, it was Section 4, that requires all agencies who are involved with all immigration programs. So now if we go back, that means State Department, that means the US Consular Post, that means CBP when they're letting you in, that means USCIS when they're making their decision on, you know, on paper at their service centers. All of those agencies that are administering immigration programs are supposed to engage in additional screening and vetting. And without and the four instance that was given was such as in-person interviews. Now, we all know your first visa stamp interview abroad is always going to be in person anyway. Not a big difference there. But when it comes to USCIS, most of the petitions that USCIS administers that have to do with graduate medical education, they basically are receiving several pieces of paper in a FedEx at a service center, making a decision and sending it back out by, you know, hard copy and sometimes electronic notification. But there's no in-person interview process that is in place for almost any academic medicine, you know, decision in immigration. So if this does get implemented, you know, this additional screening and vetting, there is some concern that that is going to slow down adjudications. And when we get to the question about J1 versus H1B, which I understand is a very hot topic for this audience, whether you're doing the J1 path or the H1B path, and if you're, for example, going for a change of status petition, that could end up, not probably yet, we aren't hearing about this happening yet, but it could end up down the road impacting how those change of status petitions get adjudicated if they're going to now start requiring an in-person interview component. Right now, there's no in-person interview component if you're just doing a change of status from, for example, F1 to H1B, F1 to J1 while you're here in the U.S. So that could be very significant. The other thing I'll say, and this is just a very recent development, you know, I mentioned that there's the State Department and the consular posts. So State Department headquarters actually on March 17th issued a cable notification that that said, all right, we recognize and understand there are temporary restraining orders out there that say, hey, wait, you can't implement the entirety of this executive order. You can't ban everybody from these countries for 90 days until we look at it in the courts. But this cable on March 17th was after all those temporary restraining orders freezing were already in place and said, okay, we recognize that we can't do certain things while those court cases are going on. But there are other parts of the executive order, for example, this one, Section 5, the one that for the additional screening. Really was encouraging the post to engage in very robust additional security procedures, again, regardless of nationality. But interestingly, one subpart here is that if a consular post, that's, you know, where you're applying for your visa, if a consular post determines that the applicant, that's anybody trying to get the visa, if the applicant may have ties to ISIS or other terrorist organizations or has ever been present in ISIS-controlled territory, the post must refer the applicant to the Fraud Prevention Unit for a mandatory social media review. They should scan the results of the review into the NIV case for consideration, et cetera, et cetera. So basically what's happening is that even though certain parts of the executive order are stayed, there are other parts that could impact those, for example, who've carried out global health initiatives or just through carrying out their lives may have been present. It doesn't even say physically resident or any, you know, resident or any other, you know, legal criteria, just present in an ISIS-dominated, and it says territory without defining what are you talking about, a nation state? Are you talking about a province? So this is very new. We don't know how that's going to impact yet. But one other kind of tip here is that part of the cable notes that posts, because of all this additional screening, should generally not schedule more than 120 interviews per consular adjudication per adjudicator per day. So what's happening is, even if you're like, no problem, I've lived my whole life in Western Europe, I'm not in an ISIS-dominated territory, you still could be impacted by this because the number of interviews per day per consular officer has decreased, right? So if you think about it, the supply of the visa interviews has gone down because of this memo. In addition, another thing on the consular post is that Section 9, which also is completely active, suspends the visa interview waiver program. Now, for those coming into graduate medical education, right, for the first time, whether you're going to get your first J visa or you're going to get your first H visa, either way, you're going to have to come in for an in-person interview. But how this could impact you indirectly is that now, instead of before people who had a visa that had expired within the last 4 years and they were going to renew, could get that visa interview waived. Again, supply demand. There were more visa interviews available because those kinds of applicants weren't taking up visa interview slots. Now, with the suspension of the visa interview waiver program, only those who are eligible, people are only eligible to get their visa interview waived if it's expired within the last 12 months in the same category. Again, that's just yet another tax on the system. You're going to have more people vying for those visa interviews. So what that means is that what we're anticipating, it hasn't happened, you know, in huge, broad scale yet, but what we're anticipating is going to happen is that there's going to be a longer wait time between your being ready for that visa interview. You know, I've got my H-1B petition approval, or I have my DS 2019 from ECFMG, and we'll talk about those alphabet later, but you know, I've got the magic piece of paper, I'm ready for my visa interview. Oh gee, wait, how long is it gonna take? So a best practice for anybody listening to this who is outside the US, if you're questioning, oh gosh, this DS 160 online form is so difficult, has anybody here had to fill out the DS 160? Department of State 160 online. Okay, no one here in this room has had to go through that headache, but probably some people listening in from abroad have. And it's a daunting process. You should consider yourselves very lucky if you haven't had to do this. But it's a very slow, clunky process, very hard. And so people sometimes, they kind of get stalled in setting up their visa. Anyway, so this is, you know, please push through that DS 160, get signed up, especially since right now, with the temporary restraining orders, the travel ban right now is not in place. All these other things are, but the suspension is not in place. So if you're from those six countries, this is the time to get your visa interview. Okay, one thing before I go into H-1B versus J-1, I know there were some questions that had come in advance about visas, and one of them was how to best be prepared for a B-1 the interview. So, for foreign nationals who are outside the United States and who are seeking to have, you know, to come into the U.S. to do interviews, right, GME interviews with a fellowship or residency program, the typical visa to do that is the B-1, B-2 visa. Now, there are those individuals from visa waiver program countries who don't require a B visa, especially if they have never visited any one of those seven countries. But there's always, you know, there can be some real difficulties that already existed, let's say, back in 2016. So one of the things that you're always having to do with a B-1 visa, you're always having to prove that you do not have immigrant intent. Now, this is very difficult because if you're going to the consulate and you're saying, yes, I do want authorization to come into the U.S. Why? I want to come in to interview for a graduate medical education program. Really? Well, that sounds to me, counselor officer, like you might want to, you're planning to come and live and stay and work here permanently. And the B-1 visa interviewee, the applicant, has to show, no, I'm coming in for graduate medical education. That's all I'm coming in to try to do is interview for that, and then I'm going to leave. then I'm going to depart. Then I'm going to either come back home or go somewhere else, but don't worry. And at that B1 interview, one of the people asked, you know, how can you be best prepared? Showing all of the ties you possibly can to your home country, showing any real property that you own, I'm going to go back here because these are the people. This is for the consular posts. You have to show ties to your home country. You want to show that you have enough money in the bank that you will not start, you know, working illegally here in the United States while you're here. Also having invitation letters and so forth that explain why you're coming in for this very discreet short visit. Another thing I would say in terms of trying to get the B1 visa, and I know this does not seem fair, but I just have to tell you like it is, if you are applying for a B1 visa, and especially if you're applying from a coast that from a post where there are foreign nationals that have a reputation, fair or not, of overstaying, coming in legally and then overstaying that visa, they will oftentimes already know things about other family members who might have overstayed or might have entered legally, overstayed, then changed status, then become a green card holder. And believe it or not, they will be quite transparent and sometimes not transparent, they meaning the consular visa officers, about what exactly your relatives, brothers, sisters, cousins, uncles, parents, I've seen it more with siblings, and be concerned that you too may come in on that B1 visa and then overstay, et cetera. So being prepared to know about the immigration status, immigration history of any of your family members as well when you go in there is a good thing to have in your back pocket and know about. Another thing, though, I will also say, because everybody I think who's tuning in here, your ultimate goal is graduate medical education in the U.S., you also want to think about when you do get that B1 visa, sometimes it's multiple entry, sometimes it's 10 years long, and it's tempting to say, oh, this is great, I've got my magic ticket, I can come in, I'm granted 6 months, the United States is a nice place to be, so in addition to this interview, maybe I'll stay around, visit some friends, and I've got 6 months, why not use it? One thing about using your B1 visa is to know that if and when you do match later, as we all hope, and you actually are going into that visa interview, again, at the consular post, they're going to have your full history. And they're going to say, well, gee, wait, why did it take you 6 months to come in and do your interview? You couldn't have been interviewing for 6 full months. And so even though customs, when you came in, gave you perhaps a 6-month period of stay, and you didn't overstay that stay, if they will look at the length of stay and say, did you really need 6 months to do an interview, et cetera? So that's one other thing to think about as you're keeping in mind the long-term goal of graduate medical education. Okay, so let's say that you have been lucky and talented and all of those things, and you've already done your interviews, you've already, by the way, all that information I just gave you about the ties to the home country, that's also very important when you're applying for an F1 visa. So if you're applying for an F1 visa to come do USMLE through Kaplan, prep through Kaplan or the like, same exact thing has to apply. You have to show them your ties to your home country. And similarly, when you have the F1 to come in and carry out that prep course, that's what you're doing, that's all that you're doing, and then you leave when that prep course is done. so just wanted to mention that. So let's say that you've gone through all of this and you've actually matched, et cetera. There are two different primary non-immigrant visa statuses for those who are foreign nationals carrying out graduate medical education. Now, I know I mentioned non-immigrant visas. The reason we call them non-immigrant visas, an immigrant visa is basically the thing that gets you to a green card. Non-immigrant visa is basically everybody else. So if you're not a U.S. citizen, you're not a green card holder, you're a foreign national, you're probably going to be doing graduate medical education in H-1B status or J-1 status. And I knew from those who are preparing me for this that this distinction is very, very important in your, for those who are looking either ahead to matching next year or who already matched, what is the difference here? And I'm actually doing something a little bit radical, which is to give you a comparison based largely from the perspective of the Academic Medical Center, or the AMC. And the reason, we'll also talk about, the physician perspective as well, but I want you to think about it this way, because really when it comes down to it, the distinction between the H-1B or the J-1, that is at the end of the day going to be determined by the graduate medical or GME program and its administration. Because either way, they're both employment-based visas. So the employer, or the, if you want to look at it, the host site for the J-1 or the H-1B petitioning employer entity, they're the ones that are needing to sign up with the government and saying, yes, we promise that this GME will be conducted by all of the laws and regulations that relate to H-1B or to J-1. And those are very different. Those programs come up with very, very different impacts. So first, we're going to talk a little teensy bit about the H-1B, and then we'll kind of talk about the J-1. So first thing you have to understand is that the academic medical centers, and when you are doing your GME and H-1B, you are doing that in a very special subsection of H-1Bs. Most H-1Bs have to vie for this very limited number of H-1B visas, 85,000 per year. And there is so much demand for these 85,000 visas that there's actually a lottery. So, and that lottery goes to lottery because there, in the first five business days of April of each of the last 4 years, and we're anticipating again next week, there were so many more who applied than were available that it went to lottery in those first 5 days. And that's for a start date that does not start until October 1. So just to give you a sense, last year there were 236,000 petitions for only 85,000 available. So the cap exemption, the exemption from that cap, not having to be under that cap, is very, very important, especially for graduate medical education, because you're not starting your postgraduate year October 1, which is the first date of a cap lottery H. You're starting July 1, right? So you need to make sure, your employer needs to make sure you're exempt from the cap. Now, a couple things came up. Has anybody heard about this premium processing suspension for H-1Bs? Yes, okay. So in terms of the premium, so there is typically academic medical centers are exempted from this cap, and they will file an H-1B, if they're going to sponsor for an H-1B, they'll file the H-1B petition for the incoming, right, resident or fellow. Mid-March is when the match happens. Let's say maybe May, maybe June, because they could use this thing called premium processing, which basically meant USCIS, you remember them, the warm fuzzy people, USCIS, here's an additional $1,225. In exchange, we want you to come up with a response to us within 15 calendar days, which is lightning fast for the government. I mean, lightning fast for immigration. But everybody got used to it because since 2001, we've been able to premium process these cases, so no big deal. You know, match, and we premium process, all works. Another important thing is that you really, and best practices, want to have full licensure at the time of applying for H-1B. And, you know, mid-March, you may not already have full licensure, so a lot of times, work everything out with the state licensing boards, file mid-May, we're fine. Well, with this very abrupt shift that was actually announced at exactly at the close of business, Friday, March 3rd, that premium processing would be going away for all H-1B petition types, including for graduate medical education, including for physicians, including for those who are cap exempt, is going to be going away April 3rd. So from March 3rd until March 31st, that's your last window of opportunity to get accepted in under this premium processing. And I will say, and I should have mentioned this in the first executive order slide, but I will say that the response from academic medicine to the shift was very swift and very supportive of international medical graduates. It was amazing. AAMC had its statement out this came out Friday evening. By Monday morning, I know the AMA, who's here, and J. Murray Johnson can talk more about their stance. AMA came out saying this just does not work, so have other organizations as well. There's something called the Conrad 30J waiver program impacted. Senator letters came out. So far, we're now almost at the close of the month. There's no indication that USCIS is rolling back on that. There's no indication that relief is going to be given. And as such, academic medical centers are, of course, trying to scramble to do what they can to have their new petitions received by USCIS by around this Friday. And it has to actually be physically received, which is very, very hard when the match results were only announced less than 14 days, well, I guess exactly 14 days, before the deadline. It's very, very hard, and you have to do certain pre-certification filings before you file an age. So rental is nearly impossible. So that is one, you know, when a lot of questions came about, well, is anybody going to do H-1Bs anymore, et cetera. The thing about the, from an academic medical center perspective, the thing that one of the many things that makes an H-1B so hard is that you cannot start until July 1, unless your H-1B petition has been approved first. And if you are outside the United States, that means that petition has to be approved, and you have to take that a petition with you to the consulate, which is now, you know, as we know, under high demand. And you have to get a visa stamp, and all that magically has to occur before July 1. With premium processing, that was pretty doable. Now that's going to be very difficult. There is something also called an expedite request, but that's very subjective, case-by-case basis, takes several weeks, and it's not nearly the same as premium processing. So we'll see. I mean, we're not yet, you know, in April. Perhaps there will eventually be enough of a, you know, I think already there have been a lot of statements by academic medicine about the unworkability, but we'll see. I mean, April 3rd, maybe they'll change back. The other thing about the suspension of premium processing is it wasn't for time immemorial. They say for up to 6 months. They mentioned they had to get to this other H's that they had backlogged. The other thing you should know, though, from these AMC's perspectives, the requirements, and this actually went into place right before the new administration, the requirements for CAP exemption changed. So now there are additional conditionalities and all that kind of thing to getting that CAP exemption to the H-1B. So there are more and more factors making the H-1B very difficult from an academic medical center perspective and even from your perspective. The other thing is that even before the current administration, the J-1 option over the H-1B has grown in popularity. As of 2015, there were basically two J's to every one H in graduate medical education. That was December 2015. That may have shifted. It may be even more J1 than H1B right now. Another thing is that, we're talking about the J1. Another thing to think about for J1 versus H1B, and I'm going to kind of have to collapse a couple slides here because we're running out of time, but if you are entering to do graduate medical education in J1 status, you will have a two-year return requirement. You will have a requirement to go back to your home country, back to the country that issued the statement of need for 2 years, unless you later obtain a waiver of that two-year return requirement. Okay. So one of the popular ways to have a waiver of that J1 requirement is through the Conrad 30J waiver program, which, by the way, is about to expire April 28th. We're working on getting it reauthorized, but right now, you know, and it keeps getting reauthorized, but just to let you know, that's also on the horizon. The important thing is this. If you do, here's one of the positives to doing GME in J1 status. At the very end, if you decide, no, wait a minute, I don't want to go back to my home country, I want to have a waiver instead to stay here, one of the ways through the Conrad 30J waiver program is to do your service, you know, clinical care 40 hours a week in a medically underserved area, in exchange for which you get a waiver. Now, this waiver carries with it an H-1B CAP exemption. So if you do your GME in J-1 status, and at the end of it you obtain a Conrad 30 J-1 waiver, you do not have to be part of this H-1B CAP lottery system, okay? If you do your GME in H-1B status, you will never have been counted against the CAP. You'll have been exempt from the CAP throughout your whole H-1B career. Then when you, at the end of your GME, try to go into private sector employment, you then have to worry for the first time about the CAP. You then have to participate, by and large, for that lottery that I talked about. Whereas if you do your GME in J and you get your Conrad 30J waiver at the end of it, then you can stay without having to worry about the H-1B CAP. Either way you go, there's a lot of pros and cons, and it's hard to cover all of them. There are some positives both for academic medical centers and also for foreign nationals of the H-1B over the J-1 when it comes to things at the consular posts. We were talking about immigrant intent, needing to show, oh, I'm not like my family members who overstayed, or, oh, I really have all these ties to the home country. The nice thing about the H-1B is you can walk into an H-1B interview and say, hey, hi, yeah, I'm coming in to do graduate medical education. I plan on staying here for the rest of my life. I want to set up my own practice. I'm thrilled to be relocating to the U.S. permanently. And they'll say, great. J-1, not so much. When you go in for your J-1 interview, you need to establish you do not have immigrant intent, just the same thing as the B-1, et cetera, which can be pretty difficult. Also, another kind of pro-con thing about the H-1B, if you are doing your graduate medical education in H-1B status, it does permit concurrent employment by another employer if that's permitted by your residency program. J-1, there's no notion of a dual employer. You just have one host institution, and that's where you are to be located. Okay. Also, to let you know, though, when you're trying to make your case for H-1B over J-1, and you know you may be talking with somebody who is within the GME program, et cetera, the academic medical centers have to pay a lot more for H-1Bs than for J-1. They have to pay government filing fees that are higher. They oftentimes have to pay outside counsel. Sometimes they have counsel on staff, but it still takes their staff time, more of their time. Whereas with a J-1, ECFMG, the Educational Council for Foreign Medical Graduates, is the institution, is really the J-sponsoring program for J-1, and they will take care of vetting you. They will take care of issuing the magic piece of paper called the DS-2019 without impacting, without having to go through USCIS first. So there are a lot of disadvantages for H-1Bs from the perspective of the graduate medical graduate medical education program. Something flipping back to your perspective as a physician, I mentioned about the H-1B visa and needing to go into the CAP lottery if you're, when you transition from GME to post-GME generally. In addition, you have an initial 6-year cap or limit on your H-1B status. And if you're doing a base residency plus a subspecialty, you eat into that 6 years pretty quickly. Now, you can extend out that 6 years longer if you make certain inroads on a green card before the end of your 5th year, but you're always staring down that 6-year clock with an H-1. With a J-1, you're permitted to carry out your GME sort of in a way as long as it takes. The default is as long as your particular trajectory takes, and or 7 years. If you're trying to get out past 7 years or past what is typically required for your subspecialty, you're going to have some real hurdles, but it's not the hard and fast 6 years unless you get green card work going before the end of your 5th year. I've already talked a lot about the pros and cons of the J, administrative costs. Also, I think these PowerPoints will be available if people want to read them in greater detail. I also want to take a quick moment, because I'm about out of time, and there's a green card slide, but I think that's very far in the future for most people. We can go back to that if people have questions on green cards. I wanted to go back to exactly how this works when you're talking about trying to go from right now in March until July 1 and starting your graduate medical education. So let's say that you're lucky. Let's say that you've matched. Let's say that your program is saying, we'll be happy to have you come here, but we will only sponsor you for J-1, right? In that case, that program interfaces with ECFMG. ECFMG then will do what is required to vet your application, et cetera, but ECFMG can issue a DS-2019. Now, that DS-2019 will have a start date of no sooner than July 1, okay? There's a 30-day sort of pre-grace period prior to July 1, such that if you are already here in the United States and you have status, non-immigrant status, that goes all the way up until 30 days before July 1, you can stay here in the United States and ask USCIS for a change of status. I want to change from, I'm a Kaplan student, I want to change from F-1 to J-1, or I'm here on B-1, I just had my interviews, or I'm here B-2 visiting my family, and I have a stay from CBP. I always look at cbp.gov and check your I-94. Don't just assume you get 6 months. But anyways, so say that you have a stay that goes at least up to that 30-day pre-J period, and you could, if you so desire, file a change of status petition with USCIS so that you don't have to leave the United States. Now, scary thing, there's no premium processing available for this. There is something called an expedite request, but as I've told you before, subjective case-by-case basis can take weeks. But that's how you would go from another non-immigrant visa status here in the States to J1 without leaving the US. Now let's say that you're still here in the States, again, that you've got an institution that's doing J1, but you don't have status that's going to bring you right up to 30 days before July 1. In that case, you are going to need to leave the United States, obtain a J1 visa from a consular post abroad, and come back in all before July 1. Now, ECFMG, and as well as many other institutions in academic medicine, has been very, very supportive of foreign national IMGs during this whole executive order, travel ban, et cetera, and has many FAQs published on their website. I'd refer you to those. As a side, I'd also tell you to go to the AAMC FAQs, which are publicly, which are published as well, that go in depth about the executive order as well. But in any event, you'll need to want, of course, you'll want to get that, what's called DS-2019, from ECFMG as soon as it's possible. You're going to need your TPL. I can't even recall what the acronym stands for. I think it's Training Program Liaison at your given GME program to interface with ECFMG to get you what's called the DS-2019. You take that DS-2019 with you to the consulate abroad. And of course, as I was saying at the beginning of the talk, with all of these potentially long waits, you want to go ahead and fill out that DS-160 as soon as you can. You want to try to get that consular appointment as soon as you can. Just and the other thing is that you can go ahead and apply more than 30 days before. You just won't be able to enter the U.S. on that visa stamp more than 30 days before July 1. So that's the J path. Okay, now let's say you're here in the United States and you're looking at the H-1B. So same exact concept applies, where if you have status that's going to take you all the way up through, if you're going for H-1B, it's not 30 days before July 1, you got to have status that takes you all the way up to July 1. If you're in that lucky position, you're here in non-immigrant visa status, and you're going to have that all the way up through July 1, you can apply for a change of status if through the H-1B. Again, that has to do with if your given GME program is able to file before March 31 for you, by around March 31, they can ask for premium process. Thereafter, you can ask for expedite requests, et cetera, to try to make that change of status all happen by July 1. The other path, just like the J-1, you could also, if you don't have status taking you up through July 1, you also could depart from the United States and then seek that visa abroad. But again, you're not in the H-1B context, you're having to wait not for ECFMG to issue the DS-2019, you're having to wait for USCIS to review the petition that your employer/GME program submitted. And that adjudicator at USCIS has to say not just, yep, this looks legitimate, this looks like a GME program, very good. They're also having to see under these brand new regulations, is that employer truly exempt from this cap under the new regs that went into effect in January? So, and I can tell you from a practitioner's perspective, somebody who does this for a living, we've already seen many, many requests for evidence for these cap exemption H-1Bs, even for teaching hospitals. It is, and when I say request for evidence, that's something where the government says, we want more information about this exemption. We want more information about your affiliations with an institution of higher education. We want more and more information, which in turn means that it takes even longer for that H-1B petition to get approved, right? So, and then, of course, as soon, the best practice is if you're already outside the U.S. or if you're going to have to be outside the U.S. to get back in is, get on filing that DS-160 as soon as you possibly can, as soon as you have a case number and it's been approved. Okay, I'm just a little bit over, but I think I have, so do I have 14 minutes for Q&A then? 14, okay. So I can either take Q&A from this audience. I still have some additional questions to go on here. I don't know how we want to do this. Oh, okay, submitted prior. Okay, so I'll go through these, through a couple more. Okay, another question here is, Okay, sorry for taking a moment here. It's small font. Okay. One is, which visa do I need to come and take the USMLE? So to come and take your USMLE exam, you have basically, there are two different options that you see the most frequently. One are those who come in on F1 status, do their prep work in F1 status, preparing for the exams with Kaplan. And I see a couple of Kaplan representatives. Are your students who are preparing for USMLE here, are they also able to take that examination in F1 status? Yes, okay. So one, yes they are, okay, yes. We got a very good yes, a really hearty yes. Yes, they can. So F1 is one status. Another status for those who have prepared outside the country and are coming in just to really take the exam, the B1 is the typical category used. For those who hail from a visa waiver program country, yeah, and don't have a B1 visa stamp in their passport, and who have not traveled to those seven nations of countries of concern, they can come in on visa waiver program for 90 days or less, take the exam, and then leave. So that's the question. And I saw a question from the audience.
B1 or B as in boy one?
Thank you, B as in boy one. So B as in boy one visa is the typical, and it's also sometimes called business visitor. And even if you're coming in as a visa waiver program country with no visa in your passport, say you're from Germany or something, you still are deemed to be a business visitor if you're coming in to take that exam. And in terms of B1 versus B2, if you were admitted to the U.S. mostly to see family and then you're going to just, you know, take the USMLE step two while you're here, that's perfectly fine as well. So that's the answer on that. Another question was about how risky is it to leave the U.S. to go back to the home country for vacation? It's a very difficult position to be in because on the one hand you hear me saying don't stay here too long, only stay here as long as you need to, and then there's other part of me but be worried about leaving. And definitely in no way, shape, or form am I counseling to stay beyond any authorized period of stay or stay beyond your DS 2019 if you're DS 2019 plus the end 60-day grace period. I apologize. Let me edit myself. Okay. Definitely don't stay here beyond your initial period of stay. So if you were admitted in B1 status, you're going to no longer be issued a nice little I-94 white card, but you will go to CBP.gov and look up, by using your passport information, how much time CBP gave you, right? And that's called searching for form I-94. And you say, okay, that's how much time I have. So don't overstay that. Also, if you're here in F1 status, you have an I-20. And you don't want to stay beyond the length of that program plus the 60-day grace period that follows that. So I'm not telling anybody to overstay those. You can file for extensions of stay in B1. But I'm not telling anybody to overstay that. On the other hand, if you're looking at, okay, do I do a change of status here in the United States or do I leave to get my visa abroad, I think there's generally a lot of uncertainty right now about how much wait time there will be at the consular posts abroad. I mean, it seems to be very, very dynamic. In addition, there are more appellate levels, as it were. There's more kind of ways to ask the government to reconsider its decision, et cetera, with petitions filed with, go back to here. Okay. There USCIS, when you have a petition with USCIS, there's much more robust, let's say, windows for dialogue between an attorney or you as the applicant or your GME program and the government as compared to U.S. consular posts. U.S. consular posts don't really have a real system, truly, for appellate review. I mean, there is something called LegalNet where you can say, oh, but you got it wrong, not on the facts, on the law, and here's the law, but it's very ad hoc and very limited, whereas USCIS, when it's making its decisions, there's a lot more that can be done in terms of asking for a motion to reconsider, a motion to review, a request informally for supervisory review. There's just much more openness, relatively speaking, on the part of USCIS, which is part of why, for those who practice in this area, we're saying, okay, if you're, it's really a case-by-case basis, but there are certain ways in which, and also USCIS will issue, I was talking about those requests for evidence. If they say, wait, we don't think we have enough here, why don't you give us more? And these requests for evidence can go on for 10 pages. I mean, they can get very, very detailed. Whereas another question that came in was about how can I receive answers from visa interviewers that reject my visa. If you're going to a consular post abroad, oftentimes they will just hand you what's called a T221G letter. That's a section of the Immigration Nationality Act. Say, nope, you're rejected, here you go. Here's your 221G letter. And it may not identify at all the grounds, or it may have it checked off a list. And it's not that kind of robust request for evidence. Here's what we'd like to see to make a decision. So those are some of the factors that you're thinking about when you're deciding, okay, which path do I take? Do I leave the US? And certainly, I mean, the general take here, just to go back to this specific question about going back to the home country for vacation, I would generally say right now there's a lot of uncertainty about, especially if you think that you may be in those, well, I have two other thoughts. If you're not in one of those six countries of concern or Iraq, which could get back on the list, if you've never been there, if you're not a foreign national of one of those countries, and if you already have a visa stamp that has not expired, so you don't have to go to a consular post, and your mother's driving you crazy because she really, really needs and wants to see you, okay, for family harmony, maybe you go home and come back in, and I don't see that being a huge problem, especially if the underlying visa stamp matches perfectly with exactly what you're doing right now. But generally speaking, right now, people are not engaging in non-emergent international travel. If you're here, you have legal authorization to be here, you're doing what you're supposed to be doing here. A lot of people are kind of postponing that until we see what comes out of all of these decisions. Because the other thing to think about, there are these temporary restraining orders in the courts. After that whole lawsuit gets settled, we might end up with a third version of the travel ban. And we don't know what that's going to look like. And that can happen when you're outside the country trying to get back in. So, I think that's kind of some tips there. I think I saw a question. Yes.
What's the process of converting F-1 to H-1B inside the United States?
Perfect. Okay. So what's the process of going from F-1 to H-1B inside the United States? So that is one of those change of status petitions that I talked about. So if you are here in F-1 and you have your I-20, and your program under that I-20 is going to end within 30 days of the start date of July 1, actually, you raise an interesting point. You might be able, possibly, to, no, I think the best thing is to wait, make sure that your F-1 I-20 is going to end at least 30 days within July 1. And then what would happen is the graduate medical education program will determine which entity of the many different entities of the academic medical center is going to be your petitioner, okay? And they will actually prepare, they or their attorneys, whether in-house or private, will prepare a full H-1B petition that you will probably not even see and that you will not sign. Because it's really the employer's petitioning for you as the beneficiary. So your name will be on it, date of birth, passport, all kinds of information about you will be on it. But it's the employer saying, hey, government, I promise that I'm going to employ this individual to do exactly this, treat under supervision, as a resident or fellow. And I promise that I'm going to keep, make good on the promise to pay X amount and all of that kind of thing. So that employer puts that petition together, files it with USCIS. One other note, wait, before you talk about your GME program filing with USCIS. Before they can even file with USCIS, they have to do a pre-filing with the Department of Labor. So one of the things that's very difficult about this tight timing for premium processing, let's say that you only, that your program said, okay, great, we're thrilled, you've persuaded us, we want to do an H-1B for you, not a J-1. Fine, fine, fine. Okay, we made the decision, let's say, today, March 29th. The problem is if they don't have an underlying pre-certified labor condition application, or LCA, that's already been certified by the U.S. Department of Labor, they can't get that pre-certified and filed by March 31. There's a pre-filing that takes at least 7 business days. So even once an employer says, yes, I'm ready to go, file an H-1B for you, de facto it takes at least 7 business days before they can file that H-1B petition. But it's when they file that H-1B petition that they check off a little box that says, yes, we're requesting this as a change of status petition, instead of the box that says, no, this is consular notification, this person is taking it to the consulate. Another little tip is that the GME employer, H-1B employer, they can check off the box saying, yes, we want change of status. It can be adjudicated. You can get the approval notice as a change of status, and it comes up with a little I-94 coupon in the bottom that will show, yay, 7/1/2017 until the end day. You're going to be here magically in H-1B status, but let's say that mom, grandma, whatever is happening in the home country, you could, if you so needed to, depart, even though you were granted a change of status, obtain that H-1B visa from abroad, and then come back in on the H-1B all before July 1, but hard to coordinate all that. So generally, if your program files a change of status petition and it's approved, you'll just stay here, sit tight, and then stroke of midnight July 1, if all goes well and it's adjudicated before July 1, you will be ready to start your GME program. Did that answer your question about the change of status? Okay. Okay, so the question was, other than GME programs, is a research program exempt from the cap? So the exemption always goes back to the employer. So whomever is going to be issuing that paycheck to you, if you think about, you know, in terms of, you know, a pay stub, who's, you know, what entity name is going to be on that pay stub, right? Who's going to be your W-2 employer? If that entity can prove to immigration, hey, I'm a nonprofit, here's my 501c3 letter, well, you're actually, institution can do a couple different things. First, if it's already an institution of higher education, and let's say, you know, it's, I don't know, University of Chicago. Okay, University of Chicago itself is an institution of higher education. No concern there. They are clearly exempt from the cap. However, a lot of times it's not just the University of Chicago. It may be some other entity. This is just a for it. It may be some other entity that's not the University of Chicago, but something like the University of Chicago Physician Group or Research Group or, you know, this or that entity that obtained, you know, the grant, right, that you're going to be working on. So when it's not the institution of higher education, that entity has to show that it's affiliated with an institution of higher education in a way that qualifies, that's active and ongoing and so forth, okay? So it has to do with that entity much more so than it does what you will be doing. Now, under these new regs that came out on January 17th of this year, they also are, in addition, going to be looking at what you're doing. But let's say you were going to do research for a private foundation doing great work, you know, curing cancer, whatever. But let's say that had no, you know, required affiliation with an institution of higher education. Even though you're doing research, it's not necessarily going to work as a cap exemption. It kind of goes back to the employer. First and foremost, if they are cap exempt, then as long as your duties are matching up with the educational objectives, et cetera, of the qualifying anchor, as it were, institution of higher education, then you can qualify. But you could be doing the same exact wonderful stuff for a private employer who's either for-profit or a not-for-profit that doesn't have that affiliation, and you would not be exempt for the cap, even though you're doing research. Okay, I think I'm over time. So I want to break so that people have some time for donuts out there or whatever.
Take about a 10-minute or less break just to set up for the panel. Whatever you need to do, we'll just set up the chairs.
Thanks, everybody.
Thank you, Kristen.
Thank you.
Thanks for the wait, everybody. So now we're going to jump to a pretty candid panel. thank you, everybody, for being here, and thank you, everyone, for watching. Okay, I have J. Mori Johnson from the American Medical Association. Large for over 10 years now. Wonderful. And then we have Daniel Nelson from Texas.
Yeah, yes, sir.
Executive Medical Director? That's correct. Correct. And then we have Kristen Harris, who, if you're just joining, she was just speaking. She's an immigration attorney. Catch her before it'll be posted again. How we're going to figure this, how we're going to come at that. I mean, it's I think they're saying 60,000 to 90,000 U.S. physicians by 2025, and it's a lot higher for nurses even. And when you have 25 to 30% of our physician workforce, 20% being nurses, that gap has to be filled. And we're all here because we believe that importance, and we're all here because we want to make sure you all know that. Hey, Mori wanted to speak a little bit about the AMA and what they're doing with their lobbying policy. Active force with the AMA.
So, first of all, thank you. Thanks for having me participate in the panel with my really good colleagues. It's really nice to be here. First of all, I have several sections under my jurisdiction, so to speak. International medical graduates is just one of them. So at the American Medical Association, we represent all medical students, residents, and physicians. I'd like to say that we represent just members, but we don't. So a quarter of a million physicians are members of the American Medical Association out of an N of 1 million. So that would be students, residents, physicians, and retirees. I think the reason why we're so effective in Washington, D.C. is because of the quarter of a million physicians that we have as members. Our members shape our policy and our lobbying agenda. So for example, when the immigration ban order came out, our Washington, D.C. staff was able to mobilize very quickly and reach out to the Secretary Kelly of Homeland Security to tell him that this particular travel ban, first of all, is discriminatory against certain people, which we do not stand for, and in addition, it could have an effect on healthcare in the United States. So if a resident or a physician from one of those countries is trying to travel and got caught up in that ban, think about the patients that that person serves in their community, and that particular restriction, delay, and ban is now affecting people in that particular community. International medical graduates comprise of about 25% of the physician population, so one out of four physicians trained outside the United States, and at the American Medical Association, we feel as though they are a necessary and integral part to the healthcare system. We have several resources, and I can go into more detail as you start asking questions, but we have a number of ways in which you can get involved, both as a member and as non-members. We have a wonderful partnership with Kaplan Medical, and we also have immigration attorney information on our website. We don't endorse these particular attorneys, however, our members constantly contact us wanting reputable immigration attorneys that they can go to. And so we have them listed on the website because those are attorneys that we have personal knowledge or personal referral from, but they're not specifically endorsed by the AMA, but we do provide it as an information point. I'll conclude by saying we are even looking further down the pipeline regarding IMGs. We just established a U.S. IMG special interest group. So for U.S. permanent residents or citizens who are going to medical school abroad, we have a special interest group to kind of keep them looped in on what the AMA is doing and asking them what resources and what benefits they would like the AMA to have for them to make as seamless as possible their re-entry back into the US healthcare system, and also helping them with all the things that they need to do to successfully match. I know we're gonna get into more detail later, but happy to be here and happy to talk to anybody afterwards about their individual situation.
Thank you, Ms. Johnson. So I think, Ms. Harris here, I think it's important to discuss what the AMA is doing when it comes to lobbying for us. I know at the AMA convention every year, I see the IMGs running around talking to everybody, strong advocates. And I think that at this point, as Ms. Harris was talking earlier about academic centers, being very forward for the IMGs, what is being done in the legal world as well as in organizations, what's being done to lobby to get these changes? Because I know you were saying that we don't know where it's going at this point with the, at least the expediting portion.
Yeah, so you mentioned the expedite, and I also want to reiterate, when I said academic medicine, that was in large part because I was thinking about people matching, we're in match season, all that kind of thing. But very much these changes, I would say the entire medical community out with very robust statements immediately in response to this executive order. That was, I mean, if you look at all the different sectors, I really think that the healthcare sector was on top of it and leading and out there even before, I don't mean to competitive, but I would even say maybe before the IT sector even got its act together to get these statements out. So I think that's great. And in terms of when you were talking about lobbying, so a couple different things. One thing is that, and this also goes back to actually when you're mentioning MA, for years and years has been very supportive of what's called the Conrad 30J waiver program, which is a way to basically attract, you know, foreign national IMGs to not only the general, to address the general physician shortage, but HHS Health and Human Services designated shortage areas, and that has been tremendously successful. And the AMA has supported reauthorization bills a time and time again as that program keeps getting reauthorized. In part because of that program and all of those connections, as if, for instance, you were asking about what about this premium processing suspension ban, et cetera. The senators who are the traditional co-sponsors for that Conrad 30J waiver reauthorization have become kind of almost the physician immigration experts on the Hill. As within Congress, they mobilized very quickly, and they Senator Heitkamp, Senator Klobuchar, Senator Collins of Maine, in a bipartisan letter to USCIS within a week of the suspension. Stated this does not work, and as a for instance, the suspension for physicians, and as a for instance, this is going to delay, again from that healthcare continuity angle, this is going to delay the ability of individuals who are here, who've been trained, you know, this is post-GME, they've been trained here in residencies, fellowships, they're ready, willing, and able to go to rural Georgia, to go to rural Illinois, to go to low-income populations in urban centers. They're ready to go. They're trained up, but they're not going to be able to do that in a timely fashion without this thing. So the very public letter from those senators was published immediately. We aren't sure yet what effect we'll see from that. The other thing is that the Conrad 30 reauthorization bill, the language is under negotiation right now. They're hoping to introduce the new bill before the recess. So that's something to watch out for, and you know, AMA has been such a strong supporter year in and year out. I know you can't speak in advance, but I would be willing to place money that we'll be getting strong support for the AMA on that as well. So.
True. So I think that's another good question that leading into is where do you think IMG should be paying attention to see as things happen because it happens so quick. I think that there needs to be a source to come. I know there's always the news. And you know, we all know the news, you have to read a lot of it to understand really what it's saying. But where would you recommend IMGs go to learn more about really what's going on? And I know, obviously, the AMA coming to immigration attorneys and getting real legal counsel is probably the best. But what would you suggest?
I want to be able to give you a chance.
Oh, don't worry about
Kaplan.
It.
Okay, I'm sure Kaplan, okay. So one thing that's relatively interesting is that the current administration, in certain ways, instead of using the formal things like the Federal Register and kind of more legalistic things, has often made this stuff public on websites. So instead of the official Federal Register and stuff, we're saying, what, you're doing stuff by website? But the good news, I guess, the silver lining to that is it's much more readily available. So uscis.gov, if you go to uscis.gov and you Google, you know, or you do a search term of executive order, will come up with its latest and greatest press releases with regard to the executive orders. And that has been how they are notifying, oh, okay, we're not going to be carrying out this part of the travel ban while we're going to abide by these temporary, etc. So believe it or not, uscis.gov is one site. Another important government website is travel.state.gov, and that's the State Department's website. And they also have been, actually, the State Department has been, was much, had a much quicker turnaround between the temporary restraining orders being issued and having a public statement out there saying, hey, by the way, because of these, you know, court orders, we're going to be doing business as usual. Don't worry, we're not, you know, going to be implementing the travel ban, suspension, et cetera. So believe it or not, I would actually go to those. And we were getting, you know, one or two statements over the weekend after the executive order that were on uscis.gov's website, and they were doing things that way instead of even, you know, issuing memos that they made available to the immigration bar, et cetera. So believe it or not, in this era, I would say using those government websites as a resource and tool is actually a good place to go. There happens to be a resources page on my firm's website for harrisvisalaw.com. That's harrisvisalaw.com. There's a resources page that also has, for additional background, you know, articles and interviews and that kind of thing. And those also have the links to the two government websites I mentioned that are issuing these press releases.
And just to follow up on what Kristen said there, I mean, we have a lot of people, I think, watching overseas. And one of the challenges is you can watch the news, you can research all you want, but when you're trying to read the tea leaves about 2 years from now, right?
Yeah.
I'm going to come and start to prepare for these exams that will allow me to get into residency. Where will the process be 18 months, 24 months, 36 months from now when I'm actually able to apply to residency? And I think one thing that both Ms. Johnson and Kyle had said was we need foreign trained physicians in the system. And for the foreseeable future, for the long term, we're going to need these physicians in the system. And so I would urge folks to have faith in that system and begin your preparation for the exams now, knowing that we cannot fill residency positions without the foreign trained physicians to come over and take part in this. And one thing out of the recent match that kind of struck me was more residency slots were made available than ever before. And we had a higher percentage of foreign trained physicians match than in many years, but we had less foreign trained physicians actually apply for the match than we had had in the past few years. And so I want to kind of reassure folks globally that we need you to apply for these positions. We have patients that need to be seen. We have residency slots that need to be filled. And you know, here at Kaplan, we provide F1 visas that allow you to begin the training for your USMLE exams and follow that process through. I work with not only our domestic centers here at Kaplan, where we have a number of them where we can issue F1 visas and help train students, but also with a global network of agents. We have over 55 agents globally that can assist with the visa process wherever you are, answer questions for you locally, where you know the regulations are different maybe than what they are here in the U.S. And so if you're looking for an agent in your area, they're all available on KaplanMedical.com. We have a full list of all of the partners that we have throughout the globe that can actually assist you through the visa process as you're looking to begin your preparation for the exams that will eventually get you into it.
If I could add on to that and just reinforce that even further, you know, looking at this from a cynical angle, and I'm an attorney, right? So we're all cynics. But you know, looking at this even from a cynical angle, you look at the stakeholders that should, by all rights, be the most anti-immigrant. The stakeholders that should say, if they were looking at their own self-interest, we don't want any foreign national physicians. We want to keep it just amongst ourselves. And if we had those kinds of self-interested stakeholders, you would look at, for example, a physician organization such as the American Medical Association. Well, guess what? The American Medical Association is saying, no, we recognize that we need foreign national physicians. We need IMGs. Similarly, I've been using this acronym AAMC, the Association of American Medical Colleges. Okay, so this is the Association of American Medical Colleges that gives people, you know, these are the institutions, you know, with U.S. MDs, et cetera, and NDOs, I suppose, as well. But anyways, you would think that they would say, no, we don't want those who've been, you know, educated outside of America. But no, even AAMC for years and years has said we have this chronic shortage, and also they keep issuing these fabulous, well, it's fabulous in terms of quality, sad in terms of message, these workforce assessments. You can look at their website, and they have the workforce assessment showing that the physician shortage is only going to increasing given the demographics of our aging population, given the demographics of the aging physician workforce, where we have people, baby boomers finally retiring, et cetera. So I think this just is to say, yes, all of the stakeholders that even would be, for want of a better word, anti-immigrant, are actually pro-immigrant, are recognizing that foreign national IMGs are part of the solution. And I think my replacement's here, maybe. So I think I will go ahead and say goodbye. But thanks for the opportunity. Sure, thank you.
If anyone needs any more to speak to her, we'll send her questions from everybody, and also you can post on our live stream. We'll also forward those. Thank you so much, Ms. Harris. So we're bringing on Dr. Raad Rashan. He is a local Chicago IMG, an internist, and he also hosts international students with AM Opportunities. So thank you so much for making it.
You're welcome.
A good segue. My hope for this panel was to sort of go over the journey. Everyone starts, US, you go to pre-med and then you go to med school, but abroad you get out of high school and usually you go right away. So, you know, you leave mom and dad's house, maybe, get to med school, and now what? So you're starting to think, what first? You're thinking, well, I got to get some clinical experience. And usually with us at AM Opportunities, we'll usually get you on a B1 visa for that. But then continuing on after that, you're thinking about getting him the country for the USMLE. Now, you were saying that Kaplan does a lot with the J1 visa.
F1 visas, actually, yep, absolutely.
F1 visa. In that middle area, do you suggest they come straight to the Kaplan centers or talk to the immigration attorneys? You know, where should they start in their preclinical years, if they're thinking?
Sure, absolutely. I mean, as soon as a student is starting to think that they'd like to come to the United States, once they've actually completed their medical education in the home country, they could come to us, and we have DSOs in all of our Kaplan centers that can assist with the paperwork that's necessary as you come through the process. We have staff that is fully trained on the process at our customer center, which students can reach out to through a 1-800 number. As I mentioned, on kaplanmedical.com, we have all of the necessary F1 paperwork that a student would need to begin, and all of the contact information, because we would like to be here for the student from the very beginning throughout the entire process. I mean, there's a lot of paperwork that needs to be done. It is a long and laborious process, and we want to make sure that we're there for the student with the answers that they need when they need them. Most of our students will come over when they begin their step one preparation and study with Kaplan for anywhere from 18 to 24 months to prepare for the step one exam, the step two CK exam, and the step two CS exam at one of our 5 Kaplan centers. We can provide F1 visas that allow them to study here in the United States throughout the term of that time. And we find that while they are studying with us, a lot of them do like to do some clinical experience and work to acculturate into the U.S. medical system to ensure that when they go through the residency application process, they have strong letters of recommendation and they can speak to the work that they have done in the U.S. hospital system. But what we find is they really need to be focused from the very beginning. I was actually talking to Mori earlier, and you were saying you were looking at the 2017 data and what was really important there and what stuck out to you, and I believe you were saying step one scores,
yep,
and interviews were extremely important. And, you know, step one, the first step, right? It's a shame when a student misses on the step one, realizes that they need to improve their scores, and really buckles down on that step two CK exam, which is that second multiple choice exam that goes throughout the process. We need our students to start from the very beginning. We want them to keep the doors open from the start. And the way to keep all of their opportunities available to them is to ensure a high score on the step one from the very beginning. Oftentimes, that is the most challenging exam for a lot of these foreign trained physicians as well, especially if they've been in practice in their home country. If they've actually been practicing clinical medicine for a number of years in their country, some of that basic science, and specifically the way we test the basic science as part of the USMLE step one, can fade a little bit. There's a lot of complexity there. And so our students tend to study the longest period of time for that step one exam, anywhere from, I would say, 5 to 10 months specifically on that one exam, with a combination of in-center resources, live classroom instruction, and question practice. That's the best way to ensure that strong step one score. Because it's a shame when a low score on the step one limits your opportunity for residency from the very beginning.
Very fortunate to have Dr. Rashan here in IMG. Was it Baghdad University?
Correct, yeah, from Baghdad University.
Wonderful. I think we always get it from all of our friends and colleagues. They always ask, you know, about the journey. And I think, you know, this may be a time just to shed light on your journey and then what you're, you know, from that relate to, you know, what would you say to the journey that others are going through now?
My journey was very long. It started in Iraq. Then I did work there for many years. Then I moved to England, Britain, for the MRCP membership of the Royal College of Physicians. Once I finished, then I decided to come to the U.S., basically for more work opportunities in this country. And I finished my steps abroad in England, between England and Ireland. Then I came here through J-1 visa. And I started my residency, finished, and decided just to pursue a career in internal medicine. Then I have to change the visa, as everybody, you know, and get the waiver J-1 to H-1, and then to the permanent residency, et cetera.
Would you relate your experience to what you're seeing at your hospital now? Because I'm assuming you're seeing the IMGs match, you're seeing the residency programs evolve.
Well, being myself an IMG, as far as I'm concerned, I did a lot of work, you know, basically academic work, you know, working and studying, especially comparing the American system with the British and the Irish system. To say the least, the British system is harder than the American system. So the people who are coming here, they are at an advantage of bypassing the whole British system. When I say that, I mean the way of getting the degree, it's more difficult. In America here, you have yourself, you study, and that's it. And then you sit the boards. Well, in Britain, you need to satisfy other people's, of course, the examination. Once you finish the requirement, you need to, there are three steps in the exam. There is a clinical, and there is oral, and there is also papers, you know. So you need to satisfy all of them before being able to take their degree. In America, honestly, this is much easier here in America compared to them.
Glad you said that.
Yeah, great to hear.
It is, yeah. There, it's, but again, I found that to my benefit when I came here. I'm more equipped, I'm more armed with materials and clinicals and knowledge, able to get the best of two worlds. And at the same time, teaching other people, you know, what I had, you know. I'm always being in academia, you know, and enjoying it.
We'll go back into some of the questions. I think some of the questions we were getting from individuals before were really specific in regards to residency applications, the match, the USMLE, and other things such as that. I think one of the common questions was, should people be studying more, preparing more or less now than they were the previous years for the USMLE?
Yes. Yes.
Yeah, I mean, I don't think you'd find us ever to say, study less, right? No, that's not the answer here. competition does continue to be more intense.
Correct.
I understand fully that there are certain specialties that historically can be seen as IMG specialties. But again, it's all about keeping your doors open. Every physician, when they come to the United States, has a goal and a dream of the specialty that they want to pursue. And the way to keep all of your opportunities open is with those higher scores. Not only is competition among IMGs very high, but the US schools continue to turn out more applicants each and every year. And as you know, we increase the applicant pool from US, both allopathic and osteopathic universities, it does become even more challenging for our IMG applicants to match to those same specialties. So scores being extremely important, clinical experience being extremely important, the ability to interview well and show that you understand and are acculturated to the US clinical system, all of these are critical. But the real issue is with the tests themselves, you know, historically we all say, do as well as you can, you can do it again, right? These USMLE exams don't have that opportunity. Once you've passed the USMLE, those are your scores for the next 7 years, right? You can't retake to get a better score on that step one exam if you've just kind of creeped past that passing standard. So A, taking simulated exams so that you understand exactly where you're going to score on test day is critical. And at Kaplan, we definitely provide simulated exams that will let you know how you're performing and where you should expect to score on test day. Practicing with realistic practice questions that are up to the standards each and every year as the MBME continues to evolve those standards, that's extremely critical as well. Practicing with old questions, practicing with questions that aren't from a trusted source. This is certainly not a way to ensure the highest score. And again, if it comes down to taking a little more time or rushing to hit a specific deadline in any particular match cycle, I would always suggest take a bit.
How much time does Kaplan usually recommend for the step one right now?
For the step one, well, we recommend 10 months for many students. Now, if you are right out of medical school, if you're coming right out of medical school and coming over to the United States, you may be able to prepare in a shorter amount of time. The shortest amount of time that an internationally trained physician would prepare with Kaplan for the step one exam would be 4 months. But that does range up to 10, you know, and you can come over on visa for an 11 to 12 month period of time if you needed even a bit more time. What we find is with step two, once you've matriculated past step one to step two, it takes a little less time, somewhere between 7 and 9 months to prepare for that exam. But we're looking at a two-year period between the two exams, once you add step two CS in, once potentially you prepare for step three before you apply to residency. It's a two-year process, and students should count on that to ensure they maximize.
USMLE, I know Kaplan now has an interview.
Yeah, we absolutely do. We absolutely do. And as the interviews have become more important in the process, we actually provide live interview workshops at three of our centers, our New York Center. We're going to be offering them at our Chicago Center. And we're looking to offer them on the West Coast as well. And these allow you to interact with standardized patients or standardized interviewers. And these have been trained to either mimic what a program director would ask in a program director interview. We have a program director that's designed the program for us. And this allows you to really become comfortable in that one-on-one atmosphere that you're going to have when you go through those residency program interviews. We're going to ask you the most common questions. We're going to help you with the answers when you struggle and really train you so that you're able to present yourself in the best light when it comes to those critical residency interviews. I mean, if you've gotten to the point of residency interview, you've got the scores, right? You wouldn't be sitting with a program director if you didn't have the appropriate USMLE Step 1 and Step 2 scores. So many students at that point rely upon those scores, rely upon previous experience. But the fact of the matter is, this is a job interview at this point. You really need to show this program why you fit in, why you belong, and why they'd be crazy not to admit you to their program.
Going hand in hand with the interview, we also had students asking about how they can perfect their English, the medical English. Mm. How do you recommend students go about that, whether in their home country or they're here?
Well.
Well, we say to come on clinical experiences because you can immerse yourself in, like for observership, it's a great opportunity to do it without having to worry about getting your hands in it. You can watch, you can feel the language and such, but I know there are also wonderful English programs if you don't have the means to travel to the States.
Sure.
There are many programs.
One of our sister companies, Kaplan International English, actually provides a lot of this preparation for English study. One thing that Kaplan Medical students find, though, is once you're actually studying in a Kaplan Medical Center, you're surrounded by physicians, right? Each and every day, you're speaking with your comrades about medicine, right? That's really, you're all studying the same material. You're all talking about anatomy or physiology or pharmacology. And so that's one thing that our students find is not only are the lectures or the materials or the books very helpful, but it's the everyday study, right? It's the immersion in a Kaplan Medical Center surrounded by students who are facing the same challenges that you're facing and really talking with them, using English each and every day. To your point, immersing yourself in it is the best way to be, to perfect it.
Oh, and also the AMA can assist with that as well. We have meetings, we have webinars. We also have a research symposium. So once you are ECFMG certified, you can actually present your original research, a clinical vignette, or a basic science poster, and there's a monetary award attached to that. But more importantly, that is additional information that you can add to your CV. We actually have a really good track record right now of all of our past winners they have actually successfully matched into a residency program, because now you have a national award on your CV. Also during the meetings, you can talk to other IMG residents who are already in a residency program. They will give you the inside scoop. So I think that's very important. Not only are the interview questions and the way that you handle those interview questions are important, something as simple as the handshake, the eye contact, and smiling during the interview, believe it or not, that makes a difference. So that has nothing to do with science. That has nothing to do with medicine. That's your social skills, your interpersonal skills, and level of comfort in the situation. I think if there's one piece of advice that I'd like to offer to all international students, you being nervous and freezing up during the interview is probably the biggest mistake that you can make. And how you overcome that is by practicing. Practicing, getting coaching, talking to Native American English speakers so that you can understand a little bit of the slang, of our customs here that might differ from your country. I think once you're here, you'll see that you can do a beautiful blend of your culture from your home country intertwined with the American culture, which is very distinct. And I'm sure the doctor can speak on that as far as acculturation and really blending the two. But I think during the interview, I like to think in terms of numbers. In most situations, the folks that are interviewing you are not IMGs. So look at it that way. A very small percentage of program directors are IMGs. A very small percentage of attending physicians or chief residents are IMGs. So that's how you should come at this. That's how you should attack it, is that the person who is judging you is not from your culture and didn't go through what you went through to be where you're at. So really explaining your journey, really impressing upon them what you're going to bring to their program. And I really think all of you are at an advantage. You can see things from an international lens. You also have been exposed to medicine without a lot of the high technology that we have in the United States. So you bring that to the table. You know, you don't need an MRI or an X-ray or test results. You've had to do it with none of those things. And I think you proving that and showing how, in addition to the technology that you will have access to in your residency program, how you're kind of bringing an additional facet to that program. That's something that you guys have that a US graduate will not have. Also, many of you, by a show of hands, how many of you are multilingual? I've been amazed. I've actually done some mock interviews with IMGs. They never talk about being multilingual. And I'm like, when we do the critique after, I'm like, why didn't you talk about the fact that you speak five languages? And they said, well, you know, I'm trying to assimilate and I'm trying to come across as like as pro-American as possible. I don't think there's anything more pro-American than somebody who can speak to their patients who all speak different languages. So I think if you twist it that way, that do your research on the program, and if you know they're in a community that has large Hispanic population, large Arab population, large Iranian population, and so forth, knowing that in advance and letting them know, by the way, I speak the language, and I know the culture, I know the food, I know the lifestyle, that's gonna make me a better physician. That program would be stupid not to want you there.
Embracing and highlighting the differences that any applicant brings to the table are critical. I think something you said rings very true, right? Sometimes people are afraid,
correct,
right, to highlight those differences that they may bring to a program. But it is those differences that are going to give you a leg up versus other applicants at the end of the day.
Correct. It is, and it'll make you memorable. So for example, if you speak three languages, they're gonna remember that. Like, wow, we had that applicant who spoke three languages. Who else speaks three languages?
Right.
And so again, you're making yourself memorable and you're adding value.
It's always a plus, not even in the residency program, but even in jobs.
Yeah.
The more language you have, it's just plus for you. They will check you, you know. It depends if there is no, if there is tough competition, you know.
Another good segue into, I mean, I guess it's before the interview, but it's choosing your program. And I know that IMGs take such an intricate, pivotal role in underserved populations and taking, especially in primary care. And I think that goes hand in hand with choosing your residency programs. And I don't know if what you would like to say on behalf of that, but I think, I know the AMA has the FRIDA database, and that's wonderful because you can see the IMG percentages matching at any program by specialty. But you do have to be an AMA member to.
No, you do not. So FRIDA is the GME database, and it is open to the public. However, as a member, you can save your searches. You can get an expanded description of that residency program. However, everyone can see, for example, internal residency program at Rush. You can see that they have 20 IMGs and 5 US MGs.
Graduates, yeah.
So, yeah, thank you. So you can actually see that. Personally, again, I'm going to go back to the numbers game. Play the numbers to your advantage. I would not waste time on a program that for 5 consecutive years has never placed an IMG. Just don't apply there. Sure. I know that breaks your heart. You don't want to hear that, but it's a numbers game. Also, go to less desirable geographic locations. So I'm talking rural programs. I actually think with the osteopathic residency programs and allopathic residency programs merging, so all of you know, is everybody aware of that? It's all going to just be ACGME is going to accredit both. What that means for IMGs is an added opportunity. You can now apply to DO programs, where DOs could apply to allopathic, but allopathic could never apply to DO. We've done away with, ACGME has done away with that. They are working hand in hand with the allopathic graduate, the acronym is escaping me, but that board. They have merged, and I think that's an opportunity. I think there's going to be more programs and more slots for IMGs, because before you couldn't apply to those osteopathic programs. Correct. So anyway, that's an additional opportunity, and then the AMA is also an additional resource, and take advantage of, do your homework, know the numbers, use FRIDA as your base research, and as I said again, look at geographical areas that may be undesirable, North Dakota, Washington State, and again, it's not a disparagement of North Dakota, but it has a lower population,
sure.
So doctors don't want
right.
to go there.
Absolutely.
It's like, go to rural communities. Really do your homework, and if they don't, if 5 years running, if they haven't accepted an IMG, I guarantee you, you're not going to be the first. You're not going to make history at that program, and rather than get upset about it, I would move on. There are tons of programs. The one that comes to mind is University of Illinois at Chicago, their pediatric program historically has been 80 to 100% IMG. So that's where you should be applying. That's where you should be putting your effort. Same thing with your specialty choice. I know we had some questions about neurology and dermatology, radiology. Those are highly competitive specialties. And you just, it's a numbers game. Figure out how many slots there are nationwide. Figure out how many applications go into neurology, let's say. Now, in your home country, if that was your specialty there, then yeah, you have a little bit of an edge, but mathematically your chances will be better. Family medicine, internal medicine, psychiatry, pediatrics. And you'll just have to do some soul searching on, it's my dream to be a neurologist, I'm only applying to neurology. Well, first of all, you do have to do the internal med and then go on to neurology, but it's going to be extremely competitive, so you have to have a reality check with yourself, especially if that score is not where it needs to be for those high demand, hot, lucrative specialties. And I can tell you right now, with all of the IMGs that I work with at the AMA, those that are in primary care, they love it. They love their patients. They love what they do. They're challenged every day, as opposed to, and not to denigrate subspecialists, but they're really doing the same thing every day. Where, I'm sure, doctor, you can say every day you've got
It's every day a different
complex.
It's a challenge every day.
Yeah.
It's challenging. And we're interacting with all the other specialties, subspecialties, so it's always dynamic, you know, on the go. Yeah.
One other thing to bridge research to interview, to our last couple topics, is you do the research on Frida. You can actually see the breakdown of foreign trained physicians versus US trained physicians for any special or for any program. And then you can go to the website of that program and actually oftentimes see the individual residents that may have trained overseas and what schools they had trained at, right? And so having that knowledge when you go into an interview can be very powerful as well, right? Maybe you studied at a school that they have a residence in, you know, process already at their program. This resident's doing a great job. The fact that you studied at the same school, I mean, you can really start to draw lines and create a resident, you know, interview package as you're going through the interview.
That face-to-face time. I mean, really, like you said, once you have the interview, you know, it's that face-to-face time that matters. And I know with clinical experiences, it's really, you come to the country, and it's really just getting to show yourself to our, you know, the healthcare community. Even if you're doing a rotation, not the residency program you're applying to, you know, you can go to that hospital that you're not at and set up a time to talk to them, because it really is that face-to-face that really, you know, we want you to be a physician in our country. You're going to have such a responsibility with, you know, with these patients that that's the main concern. You know, if you have your step scores, you have everything, and just I make the time to have the face-to-face. I think that's a good segue. And so, you know, you have the interview, and now you get matched, which 54% did this year for
253.
Yeah, which was the highest since 2004.
Correct.
But it's interesting about, I mean, we were talking about how there was a decrease of about 450 applicants.
Mm-hmm.
However, the match rates being that high are really, really nice to see.
It's exciting. I mean, we are starting to open more residency slots up, not only for additionally, you know, trained U.S. graduates, but that opens more opportunity for the IMGs as well. Mm-hmm. Match season's an exciting time of year, for us here at Kaplan especially, right? I mean, we have centers all over the nation, Chicago, New York, Miami, Pasadena, Houston. And at all of our centers, we have match parties, right? And it's a great opportunity to come in and celebrate the successes of all of our students. And actually, you can see some of the videos from some of our match students on the website now as well, which is extremely exciting. Our current students come in and celebrate. You know, we have students who are already in residency come back and celebrate with our match students. Every year, you know, we have hundreds of Kaplan internationally trained physicians who do match into a program. And it's just so exciting to see their dreams come true as they match into a program and begin that path towards actually practicing medicine. It's probably my favorite time of the year, absolutely.
So I think, going back to you more, Johnson, how can IMGs join the AMA?
Yes. Well, first of all, I hope everyone does join. because again, we're advocating on your behalf, whether you're a member or not. I'd rather have you be a member so that when we go to Washington, we can say, out of all of the IMGs in the United States, we represent 50% of them, 100% of them. Right now, in our membership, we have 17% of our members are IMGs. So for those of you who are still, so by show of hands, how many of you are students? How many of you already matched into residency? So most of you, are all of you students? Are any of you residents or fellows? Okay, so most of you guys are students. So unfortunately, as students, you cannot join unless you join the special interest group, which is free. And you get emails, and you get tips to kind of help you through the process. What we hope is that you get a little taste of the AMA and what we have to offer. And as soon as you are ECFMG certified, so you've gone through ECFMG, taken step one, step two, and then your clinical skills, you then can join for $45, and then you have everything at your disposal. Now you can really fully utilize the Frida database. You can network with other AMA members. And I didn't stress that enough in the last question. Networking and meeting as many people as possible is the name of the game. So it's great if you stay in your room or you stay at Kaplan and you study. I want you to do that. But I also want you to go to medical association meetings. You can come to the AMA meeting. So even if you're not a member, you can come, you can participate. You just can't vote. You can't run for office. You can't access anything that's members only, but you can come, you can network, and that is the name of the game. There's a saying in the United States that we're all separated by 6 degrees of separation. That is why you network. Eventually, you're gonna meet somebody that knows somebody that knows somebody that knows somebody. Just that interaction, however brief it may be, you exchange business cards, you exchange email addresses, that person might know somebody who's willing to put in a good word for you at a residency program that may not have chosen to interview you, but because this person has a connection, they will say, okay, well, fine, we'll interview this person, and now it's on you to shine. So network and go to conferences. A lot of those conferences have a student rate. Sometimes students are complimentary. All of the AMA meetings that Carolyn and I run, and Carolyn is in the back of the room, she's actually the senior group manager for the IMG section. All of our events are free. For those of you who don't qualify to be members, we can work something out. But we wanna share the information with you, and we wanna make sure you guys are linking up with each other, and you're linking up with physicians who are licensed in the US who can help you.
I would just like to plus one that comment, because not only is networking so critical, and the AMA provides a lot of fantastic opportunities for that, but there are also ethnic physician organizations that you may want to look into as well. That no matter where you study, no matter where your home country is, there is a physician organization that actually works with those nationalities. And to the point made before, it's not just students and residents in those groups. It's physicians, right? And so networking with those physicians, finding out where they went through residency, where they may currently practice, all of these things will help you when it comes time to apply to a residency.
Correct. And you'll also find out what their research passion is. And you could say, I need to get actually more research experience in the United States. I'll work with you for free. And that could open the door. That could get you a letter of recommendation. Mm-hmm. That could, that person, that researcher could call up his college roommate who is now like the president of such and such academic center and put in a good word for you. So I definitely would not turn away from any opportunity, even as small as something as, hey, I'll volunteer in your lab one afternoon a week, because my passion too is also cancer, or my passion also is MS, or neurology, or infectious disease. So if you come across somebody and that's their passion and they have research, they're always looking for people who have a scientific background to help them with that. Maybe it's just surveying patients in a clinical trial. There's a lot of opportunities. You just have to really hustle and take advantage of every interaction that you have.
We see that with our clinical experiences, where it's interesting, most of the students that match from these clinical experiences, usually you can see the chain where they came for a clinical experience, they got a research position at that place, met someone that introduced them to someone else, and all of a sudden they get matched somewhere else. And it's just so fascinating to see that it's just the stepping stone game. And, I mean, you can start that in your home country. If you can come here, get into these groups, because it's just amazing to see how well the network guides you, especially when it's just keep going at it, and the path will come. I think there was a question.
You mentioned earlier about the IMG section. So you said that that's
you can join it's called the US IMG Special Interest Group. Correct.
Yeah.
So you don't have to pay anything. You get information. You get looped in on when we're having an event. So, for example, we just came back from New York City, where we had an IMG symposium entitled Succeeding in Residency and Practice. So we actually helped IMGs navigate the whole entire match process. If they didn't match this time, we gave them tips on what they could do to increase their chances for next year. And we had tons of our special interest group members attend that event. So sometimes it's just a nominal cost to join those events, but you know, you can't vote, you can't introduce a resolution. There are certain rights and privileges that are only for members, but for this special interest group, you're still able to interact with AMA members, you're still able to take advantage of resources. Now, once you become ECFMG certified, you then can join. And we would allow you to join at the resident rate, which is $45 a year. And then with that comes all of the benefits of being a member. So voting, introducing policy, discounts, discount with Kaplan. So we actually provide a really healthy discount to members with any of the Kaplan products. So that's what you have to look forward to. But in the meantime, join the special interest group. I have my cards here. You could also see Carolyn. All we need is your name, your graduation year, and your email, and we'll put you right into the group.
The next thing is, when is the convention that you're talking about?
Yes, so every June, and Carolyn, you're gonna have to help me. What's the date? June 10th, here in Chicago at the Hyatt Regency, will be our annual meeting. And then the IMG section meets on, Saturday evening, correct? Saturday evening, and then we also have a desserts from around the world reception following our meeting. And then if you just wanted to come and see how the sausage is made, which is how we develop policy, and it's quite, it's probably the most democratic thing that I've ever seen, because everybody who comes can testify. Everybody who comes who's a credentialed delegate can vote, and they represent their state or their specialty or their special interest. And it's amazing. You can actually sit in the back and watch that sausage being made. I'm sure out of our section, there's gonna be tons of resolutions dealing with immigration, dealing with discrimination, and dealing with licensure parity, also dealing with acculturation. Those are our top issues for IMGs, and so we invite you to be a part of that. And as a non-member, you can still participate in that. It's a free meeting, and it's on our website.
I think it's important to watch that, because as you're looking at the state-by-state requirements, so obviously the first thing is the requirements for residency, but then to get state license, all the states differing, the AMA, they're the ones that are lobbying for these rules to be changed in favor of IMGs. So I think it's really, when we go every year, it's so important to watch, and you can see the policies that are coming into play are very important, and you know, the stuff that they're doing is just phenomenal.
And we need the IMG perspective in shaping those policies. You can't let those policies just be shaped by a certain cohort. We need the entire global family of medicine to come together on these issues. That's why it's so easy for our lobbyists to go to the Hill and lobby, because they know this went through an extremely democratic process. Everybody voted it in, everybody wordsmithed it to death, and now this policy is perfect, and that's now our lobbying agenda.
Questions in the audience? So this is maybe a good opportunity for some closing remarks from each of you. I think we got the point across that internationalists play such a pivotal, important part in our healthcare community. And I mean, I firmly believe it's not going anywhere. I mean, it's not going anywhere. I think you can say that. But you just have to pay attention and be diligent with the news and see what's going on, because really, at the end of the time, like, it's a numbers game. You know, you're all smart, you're all intelligent, you're all medical students and graduates, smartest out there. I don't think that's not the issue. So I think knowing that, that being said, just pay attention, and I think it's gonna be just fine.
I guess one thing I would say, medical students, physicians, an extremely bright group, as you were saying, but it's about having the resources necessary to understand the process that you need to go through. And one thing at Kaplan that I really, you know, we pride ourselves on is our medical advising. And when you're a Kaplan student in a center or working remotely online with our live online programs, you always have a medical advisor who's there with you to walk you through every step of the way, whether it's working with the DSO and visa issues, or whether it's actual content in academia. These medical advisors are there for you, They help you as you go through the entire process. And what I'm even more proud of is that we offer free medical advising appointments to anyone. So any of the students overseas who are watching this, anyone here, if you'd like to talk with an advisor just about the different paths and the different opportunities that are available to you, you can request a free medical advising appointment at kaplanmedical.com. There's a try us for free button, and it'll say, would you like a medical advising appointment? All you have to say is yes, and we'll give you time to talk about the issues that you're facing, where you are in your study process, you know, what specialty you'd like to go into, and we'll share the knowledge that we've gained over the many years we've been preparing students to help you formulate a plan for yourself. So that's there for you, whether you're a student or whether you're not a student, because our goal, again, is to assist as many foreign-trained graduates as possible gain residency here in the United States. So it's an exciting opportunity and something I would encourage everyone to take advantage.
Yeah, just a couple of points, for all of you guys, you're sitting the steps. Two things you need to put in mind. You need to have a general background pool of information knowledge for you. That's essential. And then the second step is it's an exam technique. You need to master this. You need to master this in order to be able to cruise through it, and then you'll pass it with a good degree.
I think take-home points. I think everyone should join the AMA if possible. And Kaplan, your clinical experience, AM opportunities. And I thank you, Dr. Rashan and Ms. Harris, who was very fortunate to come earlier, too. Thank you very much.
Thank you for having us.
Thank you.